Good morning. It's 7 o'clock. Hallelujah. Good morning. Praise the Lord, saints. Praise the Lord, saints. Where are all my saints at? Good morning. It's Sunday. Guess what? It's Bible study. Sisters Growing Strong. SGS Ministry. The birthday of the church. Hallelujah. This is the day. This is the day. This is the day. This is the day. Good morning. Come on, y'all. Good morning, y'all. Get up. Get up. Wake up. Come on. Good morning. Hallelujah. It's the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice. Hey, Mike. Good morning. Hey, Lee and Matt. Good morning. Good morning. Hey, Trina. Come on, y'all. We come to praise and worship today. We're going to bless the Lord this morning. Good morning.
The angels bow down at the thought of you. To the light for you.
Good morning, King. This is the day, y'all. This is the day. This is the day. Come on. We ain't got many Sundays left in the New Year, so we're going to worship, but we're going to praise him, y'all. Come on. Come on. Good morning, Cola. Good morning.
The darkness gives way to the light for you. The price that you pay gives us life brand new. Hosanna forever, we worship you.
Come on, let's worship him, y'all. Good morning. Hey, Mr. Letta. Good morning. Hey, Akisha. Good morning. It's Bible study, y'all. This is the day. This is the day.
I adore King of Kings, ruler of everything.
Somebody say, save now, Jesus. Save now. Hosanna, Hosanna.
We worship you. That my soul longs for, for the sins and the one I adore, King of Kings.
Come on, y'all. Good morning. It's worship time. Let's worship, y'all.
We worship you for your patience and honor.
Y'all, if I can sing, oh my God, I'll be bad. Oh my God,
we can't sing without you. We can't sing without you. Hosanna, Hosanna. What greater love in this world for you? To the things you do.
Hey,
I will follow you. Hosanna forever, we worship you. Hosanna forever, we worship you.
Good morning, y'all. We got another Sunday, y'all, to worship, but we got another Sunday to worship. Good morning, good morning. Hey, Miss Linda. Hi, Miss Darcy. Hey, Michelle. Good morning. Come on, y'all, get out the bed.
Hosanna forever, we worship you.
Come on, y'all.
Hosanna forever. Hosanna forever and ever, Hosanna, we praise you. Hosanna forever and ever, Hosanna, yes, forever. Hosanna forever and ever, Hosanna.
Hey, Sophia, good morning. Hey, Miss AD. Come on, I need you on my playlist. Where's the teacher, AD?
And ever, Hosanna.
Hosanna, Hosanna, forever. Hosanna, forever. Hey, Brooke.
Hosanna, we praise you. Hosanna, you're worthy. Hosanna, you're worthy.
Hosanna, good morning, y'all. We love you.
We love you. We love you. We love you. We need you.
Who need him? Come on, I need him this morning.
We need him. We need him. Gotta have you. Gotta have you. Gotta have you. Gotta have you.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Hey, Miss Beverly. Hey, Stacey. Good morning. Hey, sis, is growing strong. Hey, Peaches, y'all, I'm so excited. I need them, I need them, I need them. I know you need them just like I need them. To God be the glory, hallelujah. This is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make a boast in the Lord, and the humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I'm telling you, I'm excited because I sought the Lord, and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant. Are you radiant? Do you look to him? The word says those who look to him are radiant and their faces are never covered with shame. Come on. This poor man cried out. This poor woman cried out. Have you cried out in a while? When was the last time you cried out? It says this poor man cried out and the Lord heard him. You got to cry out and he will hear you. That's what the word says. The word says this poor man. I don't know if you're rich or you don't need him, but this poor woman cried out and the Lord heard me and he saved him out of all his troubles. I don't know what trouble you in. I don't know what trouble you have. I don't know what you have going on, but I'm telling you, if you just cry out, he said that he answered him and he saved him from all of his troubles. Come on. Good morning. You don't got much time left. So you got to cry. You got to scream. You got to cry out. Whatever you need from him. He said, this poor man. It don't mean poor financially. Sometimes it means poor spiritually. It just means that you might be going through a whole lot. And you just at a weak moment. And this poor man cried out. And he heard him. I know you probably like, I'm tired of crying. I ain't crying. I cried my last tear like Mary. But I'm going to tell you something. He heard him after he cried. You got to cry sometimes. This poor woman cried out. Y'all know I'm going to cry. I'm going to cry it out. You got to let some of them tears cry, come down, because guess what? That's cleansing for your soul. It says this poor man cried out and he heard him. The angel of the Lord encamped around those who fear him and he delivers them. Guess what the next verse says? It says, taste and see that the Lord is good. When was the last time you ate the word? When was the last time you tasted him for real? It was like, oh my God, this is good. He's talking to me. When was the last time you ate the word and you digested it? And then by the time it was time to come back up, it came up and somebody else received it. Come on. The last time you ate the word and the Holy Ghost allowed you to touch somebody else's life with his word. You got to taste and see. You just can't see. You can't see other people's blessings. You can't just say, oh my God, they're doing so well. Oh my God, look how God blessing them. You got to taste it for yourself. You got to taste and see. You got to eat that thing. Guess what? We've been eating the word all pandemic. This whole pandemic, we've been eating the word. But are you regurgitating it back up? Do your mouth still sound like you're not eating it? Come on. What are you eating? You got to eat the word. He said, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. Refuge. Do you know what that means? That means you got to go to shelter. He's your shelter. He's your wings. When you go up under his wings, he will hide you under his tabernacle. That means you can go to him. And he will cover you. Whatever you've done, whatever situation, he will cover you. He's your refuge. Like a baby run to their mom when they're in fear. You can run to God and say, God, I need you today. I got to have you because you're Hosanna. Save me now. That's what that means. Save me, God. I done messed up. I done made a mistake. I made the wrong decisions. Help me, God. I don't know what I'm doing. My life is a mess. I thought I was doing right, but it's all out of control. I need your help. Be my refuge in the time of storm. That's what he said. It says, the blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. You're blessed when you take refuge in him. Not take refuge in your money. Take refuge in your family. Take refuge in your friends. He said, take refuge in him. And then you say you're blessed. Come on. It says, fear the Lord, you his holy people. Are you holy or are you pretending? He says, fear the Lord. That means have reverence for God. That don't mean be afraid. That means have reverence. That means bow down. Be willing to let yourself die. You got to kill this flesh sometimes. You got to have reverence for God, that he is holy, that he's here, that he's omnipresent, that you know he's in that place. He's everywhere you are. So when you make a decision, when you say something out of your mouth, when you're about to do something, just know that he's right there. You got to have reverence to know that God is always with you. You have to know that. For those who fear him lack nothing. If you're lacking in any area, it's because you're not fearing God. You gotta fear God. The word says, for those who fear him lack nothing. I lack nothing. Now, I want some stuff, but I lack nothing. That's what you gotta remember. You may want some stuff, you may need some stuff, but you will never lack. Say, I will never lack because I fear God. Even when you mess up and you have a reverence to go back and ask God to forgive you and you repent, you can still receive what you need from God. He said, you will lack nothing. He said, my children will never be begging for bread. Never. Not just food. You won't be begging for nothing because he will always give you what you need. If you just look back over your life when it seems so hard, you just look back and say, I remember when I was looking for something. I needed this, when I needed that. And look how it's 10 months later or one day later or 2 weeks later and you're out of that situation. You ain't even realize it because he made sure that you lacked nothing because you feared him. You got to just remember, even if you're in a situation right now, you're like, I need you, God, I need you. Don't look like you're here. But guess what? I was there before and I'll be there again. You won't lack anything. It said the lions may grow weak and hungry, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. You got to seek him. Are you searching for him? Are you looking for him? Or are you just expecting him just to show up and give you this big blessing with this big pot of gold after the rainbow? He ain't coming like that. You got to taste him. You got to eat the word. Come on. You will lack no good thing. He says, come, my children, listen to me. Are you listening? Or are you just on here? You just want something to do because you just used to getting up at 7 o'clock. Or are you listening? He said, come and listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Sometimes you might not know how to receive God. So he said, come and listen. That's why you can't just say, I know God. I don't got to go to church. I don't got to hear a minister. You have to be under a teaching. You have to be under a minister of the gospel. You have to be under somebody that is teaching the word of God. He said, come and listen to me. The word comes through a minister. A word comes through a man or woman of God. You have to be under some type of teaching to listen, to hear. God will sit on your lap, but guess what? He will send somebody to do it for you. You cannot just receive by just going about your life willy-nilly. You have to sit still and you have to read the word so he can speak to you. It says, whoever of you loves life and desires to see many good days, keep your tongue from evil and keep your lips from telling lies. You got to stop lying. And I don't know who that's for, but you got to stop lying. Keep your lips from telling lies. Just don't say nothing. If you feel like you got to say something, just don't say anything. He said, keep your lips from telling lies. People be making up stuff for nothing. Just be quiet. A lot of times we realize that God is going to do something for us. You make up something and now you done missed your blessing all because you're lying. Keep your lips from telling lies. Just be quiet. It says, turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. Turn from evil. And don't nobody know what you're doing. Don't nobody know what sins you in. Don't nobody know what you are doing. But I'm going to tell you something. When he says, turn from evil and do good like a child, you can say, don't do that. Don't touch that. And then turn around and come the other way. That's the same way with us as adults. You have to be willing to turn from evil and do good. It's just simple as that. You got to seek peace and pursue it because sometimes so much calamity is going to come your way, but you got to seek peace. That means you got to go after it. You got to go after it. You got to ask for peace. You got to go after peace. It's so hard to ask for Jehovah Shalom to come because it seems like so much is going on. Oh my God, I got so much going on. I don't know what's going to happen next. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I don't know what's going to happen next week. My family keep dying. All kinds of stuff is happening, but you got to seek peace. And where you find peace? You find peace in the refuge of God. You find him when you read the word. You find him when you pray. You find him when you fast. You find him when you study. It says the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous. Are you righteous? You want God to be all over you, but are you righteous? Are you making right decisions? Are you being fair? Are you acting like a child of the king? Are you? I'm talking to you. And his ears are attentive to their cry. Do you know that the righteous, God hears the righteous? Soon as we start crying, he hears like a baby. Soon as the baby cry, you can be in a deep sleep, you jump right up and go to the bedroom. You don't need a monitor. God hears you just like that, like a baby crying. He hears you. He said his ears are attentive to your cry. Attentive. Soon as you start crying, you ain't got to have no tears rolling down, but soon as your heart start aching, he hears you. He already know what you need, but when you call out, When you cry out, he hears you. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Come on. Do you know that Psalm 34 verse 16 just said, but the face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to blot out their name from the earth. Every time you about to do evil, you got to stop and say, will he blot my name out of the earth? That means he's just going to erase you off the, come, oh my God. Blot your name out of, from the earth. What? Blot your name. That means you're going. You keep doing evil. I'm done with you. I'm over it. Come on. What in the world? You gotta want to be righteous. You gotta want to be righteous. Something in you gotta say, not today. I'm not gonna mess up. I'm not gonna do that. I'm not gonna mess up. I'm not gonna do that sin. I'm just gonna just turn around. I'm gonna sit my butt down. I'm gonna watch TV. I'm gonna get on the phone. I'm gonna just drink some water. I'm just gonna sit here and just drink some water and just be like, whatever. Because sometimes we make wrong decisions by just being so fast. But I'm telling you, he said the righteous cry out and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from all their troubles. I don't know who that's for today, but he says he delivers them from all their troubles. Not some, but all their troubles. How many troubles do you have? I got a lot of stuff that I got going on, but I don't have that many troubles. But when he says all their troubles, if you have a lot of troubles going on, he says that the righteous cry out and the Lord hears them and he delivers them from all their troubles. And the Lord is close to the brokenhearted. I know so many people right now, today, whose hearts are broken from all the death, from all the calamity, from not having a job, from their finances is so low, from them, for their loved ones just being sick. It's so much going on in this season. And people's hearts are just broken. And they want to know, why God? Why me? Why are you allowing this stuff to happen to me? Oh my God. But he said he's closer when your heart is broken. He's closer then when your heart is whole. You know that when your heart is broken, God is closer to you. So it's okay for your heart to be broken. But just know, when your heart is broken, God is sitting on your lap. He's right there next to you. He's standing next to you. He's covering you. He's your refuge. He's going to make sure that you don't fall too far. He's closer when you're brokenhearted. And he saves those who are crushed in spirit. Sometimes your spirit is so broken. Your spirit is so crushed from situations and issues. But guess what? That's when he's the closest. Never feel like he's not there when you're more sad, when you have more anxiety, when you're more stressed out, when you're more depressed. That's when he comes. He never leaves, but that's when he's there even the more. When your spirit is crushed. Sometimes people can do something to you and your spirit just be crushed. And you just can't get over it. You don't know why and what is going on. I don't understand. But I'm telling you, at that moment, God will show up. That's when he shows up. When you're at your lowest point, that's when he shows up. And when he comes like a thief in the night. And he will bless you instantly because he see how sad you are. He see how depressed you are. He see how much stress you're in. He see what your kids are going through. He see what your life is going through. He see how your life is just going over and over again with issues and trials and tribulations. But guess what? He comes. He comes. I don't know who that's for. He comes. In the midnight hour, he'll turn that thing around. I don't care how crushed you are. I don't care how bad your spirit is. I don't care what you're going through in this season. This has been a trying season for a lot of people. But I'm telling you that when he comes, he will show up. And he will let you know that it is me. It is your Father. It is Abba. It is Jehovah Jireh. I am the one. I am El Roy. I am the God who sees you. He sees you. He sees your situation. He knows what you're going through. He said, I know you're crushed. And can't nobody else help you but me. But you got to taste and see. You got to taste and see. You got to keep tasting them. You got to keep eating this word. He said, the righteous person may have many troubles. He said, the righteous person. I just asked you, was you righteous? If you're righteous, you will have many troubles. You're not exempt. You're not exempt from going through something. He said, the righteous will have many troubles. Come on. But, somebody say, but God. He said the righteous will have many troubles, but the Lord delivers them from them all. Hallelujah. He delivers them from them all. He will get you out of every situation that you're in. Everything you need from him, he will give you because you are righteous. He said, the Lord will deliver you from them all. Somebody say all. First he said many, and then he said all. You will have many troubles. But the Lord, somebody say, but God, he will deliver you from them all. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. That's a thank you, God moment. Hallelujah. You're worthy, God. Thank you, God, for many troubles. Thank you, God, for things that's constantly happening in our lives. Thank you, God, that you will show up, God. Thank you, God, that you will relieve us from all of our issues. He will relieve us from all of our stress. He will deliver us. He will, because we're righteous, from all of your troubles. I know it's been a trying season. I know it's been a hard season. I know things have just constantly been happening, and things have been happening out of the blue. But I'm telling you, if you just read Psalm 34, it's just a good place to sit in. Because he said, the righteous, when I hear you, I will deliver you. You got to talk to him. You got to say, God, I need you right now. Not another second, not another minute, but I need you now. Most gracious eternal Father, we bless your holy and righteous name. Father, we thank you for being the anointed one. Father, we thank you that we can cry out and you hear us. God, we need you today like never before. It's getting tough. It's getting hard. The road is getting hard, God, but we need you to show up. Go before us. Let your blood go before us, God. Father, cover us on every side. We need you, God, like never before today. Not tomorrow, not next week, but we need you today. Holy Spirit, have your way today in every household that is on this live today. Father, we love you. We honor you and we adore you. Father, forgive us for our sins, recognizing that we come short of the glory every single day. Oh, God, we need you to guide the glory today. Give us a rhema word today that we might be able to go on and run on and see what the end will be. So, Father, we ask you to heal, deliver, set free. Father, touch lives right now, God. Sit in the boat with us, God. We need you, God. We're trying to press on, but we need a little bit more help. So, Father, we're tasting the word today. Father, I ask you to touch my lips of clay. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable. Let it be acceptable, God, in your sight. Oh, Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Let the people of God say amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Good morning. Psalm 34. You got to just say, no matter what I'm going through, I will bless the Lord. And his praise shall continually be in my mouth. No matter what it is, no matter what it looks like, no matter what you're going through, I will bless the Lord. Come on. I say that all the time because you got to bless the Lord in season and out of season. When it feel good, when it don't feel good. When it look right, when it don't look right. When it sound good and when it don't sound good. When it hurts and when it don't hurt. Come on. You got to constantly bless the Lord with all your soul. With all your soul. I don't know who that's for, but late in the midnight hour, God's going to turn it around. He's going to work in your favor. Come on, late in the midnight hour, it might not happen right now, but in the midnight hour, he's going to turn it around. Because you constantly bless the Lord, even when it didn't feel good. I bless the Lord today. I am excited because we're making it to the last of the few Sundays of this year. We ain't got much time, y'all. So I'm telling you, whatever you need to do in this season, it's almost up. Get your finances in order. Get your house in order. I mean, I'm telling you, The things that need to be done in your house, get it right. Get your stuff right. Get your stuff in order. Because when January 1st hit, this is going to be a brand new season. A brand new season for some people. God's going to turn it around, whatever you need. But you got to constantly bless him. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We are in the birthday of the church, Acts chapter 23. I am so excited because we are almost done. I'm so excited. I know last week we were talking about Paul and how God stood next to him and said that for him to take courage. Well, Paul is now about to be in a place of being killed. They trying to kill him, y'all. And we are in Acts chapter 23, verse 12. I'm so excited that late in the midnight hour, he's going to turn it around. Oh my God, that's in my spirit. Hallelujah. Well, let's go to Acts 23, verse 12. The next morning, some Jews formed a conspiracy and bound themselves with an oath not to eat or drink until they had killed Paul. More than 40 men were involved in this plot. They went to the chief priests and the elders and said, "We have taken a solemn oath not to eat anything until we have killed Paul." Now, I want to stop right there for a second. Now, we know that Paul was taken to the barracks by the commander. They had lifted him up and took him to the barracks. So God had removed him from the situation of them trying to kill him. And the Jews was furious, wanting to kill him. But God stood next to him and said, "Paul, take courage. You will preach the gospel in Rome." So Paul already understood that not only will he be bothered by these people and hurt by these people, but also that he had word from God that he will preach in Rome. So he knew that he was going to make it out of Jerusalem, right? And him taking courage, he had to just stand and deal with whatever they were going to give him. But they wanted to kill him so bad that they started fasting until they killed him. They said, "We will take a solemn oath and not eat or drink anything." How many times have we fasted with the wrong motives? They were fasting, trying to, literally have God be on their behalf. You cannot fast with wrong motives. If you want God to do something for you, if you need God to rain down on you, you need God to hear your voice, you need God to really, really bless you in an area, and you say, "You know what, I'm going to go on a fast." Reverend Lee always tells us to fast. And your motives is really wrong. You know that God is not going to bless you in that area. You have to have right motives when you're fasting. They said, "We will not eat or drink anything until we kill Paul." If you say, I'm going to fast until God give me all this money to get my house done. That's not a good motive. You have to have right motive when you are fasting. Do you know that fasting is essentially just for you? God don't get blessed because you're fasting. You get fasting because you're killing your flesh, because you're becoming in a place that God will hear you. You are really, literally at a place where you're at your weakest moment and God hears your cry. And then he says, "You know what? She has denied her flesh. She has come down. She has sat down. She has read my word. She has really, killed the flesh. Now I can hear her. Now I can hear him." And God now at that point will use you in that moment because you are empty, because you have surrendered all and your motives are right. Whatever you need, he will give you even more than what you're coming to ask for. He will change so many situations that you'll be like, "Wow, I didn't even know that I needed that." But he knew what you needed. So fasting is not for wrong motives. Be mindful that when you fast, write down things that will be in the right frame of mind. Don't do it wanting things like, "Hey, oh God, give me this. Oh God, give me that. Oh God, give me this. God, give me that." You might need things, but be mindful of your motives, because we don't realize that our wrong motives will hurt us in the end. These men was trying to kill Paul, and they were trying to ask God for their help in fasting. It then goes on to say, "Now then, you and the Sanhedrin petition the commander to bring him before you on the pretext of wanting more accurate information about his case. We are ready to kill him before he gets here." They are going to ambush him when he gets there. They're like, "Bring him here, bring him to us before the Sanhedrin, and we're going to kill him." They were prepared that as soon as they brought him to the Sanhedrin petition from the commander, they was going to kill him. So guess what? It says, "But when the son," somebody say, "But when the son of Paul's sister heard of this plot." Now, mind you, Paul's nephew was in the place where they were when they were talking about it. They did not know he was there. It says, When the son of Paul's sister heard of this plot, he went into the barracks and told Paul. You never know when somebody's in your midst. You better watch what you say. You better watch what you say. God will have somebody right in the midst when you're running your mouth, when you're talking, when you're plotting against somebody, when you're saying things you ain't got no business. God will use that situation and help you out. Come on. That young man was standing in the place where those 40 men was at, heard the plot, and guess what? Used it. Guess how he's going to use that situation? He's using this young man to literally go to Paul and tell him what's about to happen to him. Y'all got to watch your mouth. Y'all always running your mouth. You never know that one particular time will not only hurt that child, when you're trying to hurt that person, it will help them. Paul's nephew ran to go tell his uncle what they about to do to him. You don't know who's in the midst, so you better watch your mouth. Y'all putting your mouth on people. And guess what? God is going to use them. And they're going to tell. And you don't even know they right there. Watch your mouth. Stop talking about people. Stop plotting against people. Stop trying to hurt people. Because that thing going to boomerang and hit you. You got to watch your mouth. It says, then Paul called one of the centurions. Paul like, oh my God, let me call one of the centurions. I can't believe you just told me that. And said, take this young man, take my nephew to the commander. He has something to tell him. So he took him to the commander. I want y'all to know that this young man, this was the first time that anybody of Paul's family members was even identified in the word. Nobody else's, I mean, his family was not identified in the word at all. And the scholars believe that Paul's family disowned him when he became a Christian. But his nephew was the only one that was ever spoken of. And the reason why the scholars believe that his family disowned him, because in Philippians chapter 3, verse 8, I want to go there real quick. What Paul has said, the word that he used in Philippians chapter 3, verse 8, he said, what is more, I consider everything a loss. So when he said that he considered everything a loss, they understood that he was talking about his family, his money, his whatever his positions was, all of his intelligence. He considered it all a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Jesus Christ, his Lord. So he lost everything. So that's why the scholars believe that none of his family even bothered with him anymore once he became a Christian, because of those words. Let's go on. Paul's nephew was able to go to the jail. Even when Paul was detained, he was able to go to the jail because he was his family member. Only time somebody could come see Paul was they had to be related to him, to feed him, or to give him any news. So he was able to do that. So it goes on to say, the centurion, verse 18, so he took him to the commander. Now they took this young man to the commander. God used a child. Oh my God. He used a child. He took the child to the commander, and the centurion said, Paul, the prisoner, sent for me and asked me to bring this young man to you because he has something to tell you. Do you know that when God uses a child, he will use the least of things when he intervenes for you. The smallest things, the youngest thing. You don't never know how it's going to come. You never know how God's going to intervene. So be careful to shun somebody away, to shun something away. God will use a young person to be able to bless you, to be able to protect you from being killed. So you got to always keep your ears open because you never know when God will use the smallest thing. God loves children. I want to go to, let's go to Matthew 18, verse 2 to 6. I want to just show you how much God loves children, because he used a child in this moment so that Paul won't be killed. God said, Jesus Christ said, truly I tell you, this is Matthew chapter 18, verse 2 to 6. Truly I tell you, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever takes the lowly position of this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. So when they received this child, they were welcoming Christ. They didn't even know that God was in the midst. Come on. He was in the midst. And he's about to free Paul with him just being there listening to them plotting on his uncle. It says, verse 19, the commander took the young man by the hand, drew him aside and asked, what is it you want to tell me? He said, some Jews have agreed to ask you to bring Paul, my uncle, before the Sanhedrin tomorrow on the pretext of wanting more accurate information about him. Don't give in to them, because more than 40 of them are waiting to ambush him. They have taken an oath to not eat or drink until they have killed him. They're not going to eat until they kill him. They are ready now, waiting for your consent to their request. The commander dismissed the young man with this warning. Don't tell anyone that you have reported this to me. Come on, somebody say, God is in the midst. He's working on your behalf. That's how God works it out. You locked up. You locked up in jail. You locked up in your situation. You locked up in your issue. You locked up in your stress. You locked up in your depression. And guess what? God is working it out. God is using his child in the midst of your situations, in the midst of what you're going through. God is working things out. He's working it out in your favor. He's shifting stuff. He's moving stuff out the way. And guess what? He's doing it on your behalf and you don't even know what's going on. He's using a child in the midst of Paul being locked up, being ready to get killed. He had to bring a child. He says, then he called two of his centurions and ordered them, get ready, a detachment of 200 soldiers. Now, guess what? It was 40 men about to kill Paul. They were fasting. And now, because of this child, the centurion now went and got 200 men, 200 soldiers, 70 horsemen, and 200 spearmen to go to see Caesarea at 9 o'clock tonight. Look how many people God has got the centurion to use on Paul's behalf. He done got way more than the 40 to go before God, go before Paul so that he won't get killed. He got 200 soldiers, 70 horsemen, and 200 spearmen. Guess how much God will do for you when he go before you. You say, God, go before me and cover me in your blood. And when God go before you and cover you in his blood, he's already making it happen. He's already taking care of the things. He said, I'm Jehovah Shammah. I am the God who's there. I will go before you. I will go before your doctor's appointment. I'll be going before the lawyer. I will go before you. So when you get there, come on. When you get there, it's already handled. He handled it before they even got there. Paul was about to get killed by these 40 men, and God sent hundreds and hundreds of men before him by 9 o'clock. Look what time it is. It's at night. He's going to work it out in the midnight hour. Come on. He didn't let a day go by. He said, get in order, get in place, get in your cadence, because I need you today. Look how many people he sent. He said, provide horses for Paul so that he may be taken safely to Governor Felix. Do you know that God will provide for you? He provided for Paul in this moment, all because the little child was listening. Look how the child will listen and do what's necessary. And we as adults won't even listen and do what's necessary. He used a child and had him safely taken to the governor in Caesarea. He will provide. Say, God is Jehovah Jireh. Stop always looking for money. He will provide in the midnight hour. He will send the horsemen. He will send the soldiers. He will send the army on your behalf. He sent the whole army so they wouldn't kill him, because he knew how serious fasting was. That fasting is so serious to God that stuff will happen. Stuff will take place when you're fasting, when you're killing the flesh. So they was doing everything in their power to kill Paul. And they went to the highest point, and that was using God. And guess what? They needed so many more people so that if they tried to kill him, they would have the combat. They would have somebody to shoot back. Guess what? God will provide for you just like that. Just like that. He will send the people and will have you safely in the arms of whatever you need. He sent him to Caesarea to Governor Felix. And now I want to explain to you, Governor Felix was in a position, the same position that Pontius Pilate was in when they killed Jesus Christ. So he was in that position to say yay or nay, right? He was the governor. He was the Roman governor. And when they went to Caesarea, that was the Roman headquarters. Even though they were in Jerusalem and the Romans were over the Jews, when they went to Caesarea, they was in another place. They were like, that's like us going to court with the DA, and now you're in media and you have to go to the higher part. You have to go to the part where they have a trial. You got to go to the serious part. I haven't been to court, but I know there's a much, much more serious part when they take you to the place where now you have to go to trial. And now he's at that place, he's at Caesarea. He said he wrote a letter as follows. Now, the commander, the centurion, wrote a letter for the horsemen to take with them when they dropped him off. It says, Claudius Lysias to His Excellency Governor Felix. This man was seized by the Jews, and they were about to kill him. Now, this is the letter. But I came with my troops and rescued him, for I had learned that he is a Roman citizen. Now, we know that they can't kill a Roman citizen without cause. So they don't have a true cause yet. They don't have no real accusations. It says, verse 28, I wanted to know why they were accusing him, so I brought him to their Sanhedrin, to the Sanhedrin council. That's the council. I found that the accusation had to do with questions about their law, but there was no charge against him that deserved death or imprisonment. When I was informed of a plot to be carried out against the man, I sent him to you at force. Come on. God will send for you at force. Come on, God. I also ordered his accusers to present to you their case against him. Verse 31. So the soldiers, carrying out their orders, took Paul with them during the night. Come on. Somebody say he will turn it around at night. It might look bad in the daytime. It might not look right during the day. It might look a little gloomy. But I'm telling you, it's at night when it happens. It's in the midnight hour. It says Paul was they took Paul with them during the night and brought him as far as Antipatris. The next day, they let the cavalry go on with him. When they returned to the barracks, when the cavalry, now I want to tell you what the cavalry is, because I had to look that up. A cavalry is it's a group of soldiers that who fight on horseback. So when I first said, I thought it was cavalry, but then I said it's cavalry, and it's a soldier. So it's now in these days they have moderate armored vehicles. They're no longer on horsebacks. Soldiers, we know our soldiers in the army, they're not on horses anymore. They actually have modern armored vehicles. So that's the same thing. They are their soldiers. So when those soldiers brought him to them, they took the letter. They delivered the letter to the governor and handed Paul over to him. The governor read the letter and asked what province he was from. Learning that he was from Sicilia, he said, I will hear your case when your accusers get here. Then he ordered that Paul be kept under guard in Herod's place. So now Paul was there safely. Now he's in the barracks with in Caesarea. Now, Felix said, I will listen to you, but I got to wait till your accusers get here. Let's go to chapter 24. 5 days later, the high priest Ananias. Now, we remember the high priest Ananias, the one that smacked him, that got the soldier to smack Paul in the face. It says he went down to Caesarea with some of the elders and a lawyer named Tertullius, and they brought their charges against Paul before the governor. When Paul was called in, Tertullius presented this case before Felix. We have enjoyed a long period of peace under you, and your foresight has brought about reforms in this nation. Everywhere and in every way, most excellent Felix, we acknowledge this with profound gratitude. But in order not to weary you further, I would request that you be kind enough to hear us briefly. We have found this man to be a troublemaker, stirring up riots among the Jews all over the world. He is a ringleader of the Nazarene sect and even tried to desecrate the temple. So we seized him. Now, what is the Nazarene sect? The Nazarene sect they referred to, which was the Christians. They were named after Jesus' hometown, which was in Nazareth. So that's why they were called the Nazarene sect. And even tried to desecrate the temple, so we seized him. By examining him yourself, you will be able to learn the truth about these charges we are bringing against him. The other Jews joined in the accusation, asserting that these things were true. When the governor motioned for him to speak, Paul replied. Now, guess what? You'll always have an opportunity to speak. Somebody say, I will have an opportunity to speak. You will speak on your own behalf. Nobody will have to speak for you. I know that for a number of years, you have been a judge over this nation. So I gladly make my defense. You can easily verify that no more than 12 days ago, I went up to Jerusalem to worship. My accusers did not find me arguing with anyone at the temple or stirring up a crowd in the synagogues or anywhere else in the city. And they cannot prove to you the charges they are now making against me. However, I admit that I worship the God of our ancestors as a follower of the way, which they call a sect. I believe everything that is in accordance with the law and that is written in the prophets. And I have the same hope in God as these men themselves have, that there will be a resurrection of both righteous and the wicked. We know that there will be a resurrection of the righteous and the wicked. We know that we will all be judged. That's what he's saying. So I strive always to keep my conscience clear before God and man. How do we keep our conscience clear? We have to repent. We have to fear God. We have to have reverence for God. That's how you keep your conscience clear. After an absence of several years, I came to Jerusalem to bring my people gifts for the poor and to present offerings. We know he done that to the Ephesians. We know that he came to bring gifts. I was ceremonially clean when they found me in the temple courts doing this. There was no crowd with me. Like, I ain't had no entourage. There wasn't nobody with me. It was just me. Nor was I involved in any disturbance. But there are some Jews from the province of Asia who ought to be here before you and bring charges if they have anything against me. Like, where they at? I want to see them. Tell me where they at. They the ones should be here. Or these who are here should state what crime they found in me when I stood before the Sanhedrin. Unless it was this one thing I shouted as I stood in their presence. It is concerning the resurrection of the dead that I am on trial before you today. The only thing they will have against you is that you love the Lord. Come on. They can't have nothing against you. He said, the only thing that will have against me is that the concerning of the resurrection of the dead that I am on trial before you today. Then Felix, who was well acquainted with the way. Now, mind you, Felix understood about the Christian faith because he was in a position after Pontius Pilate, after Jesus Christ died, and after all those that became Christians, he knew about all the Jews that was converted. He knew about the day of Pentecost. He was in position in Caesarea at that time, so he understand about the way. He know. So he said he was well acquainted. He knew about the word. He knew about Jesus Christ, okay? He adjourned the proceedings. When Lysias, the commander, comes, he said, I will decide your case. So he needed to talk to Lysias to decide his case. He ordered the centurion to keep Paul under guard, but to give him some freedom. Now, he had him under guard, but he probably didn't have him all bound all tight. But he gave him a little bit of freedom while he was in jail and permit his friends to take care of his needs. So his friends, not only his family members came for him, but now his friends was able to come and take care of whatever Paul needed. Several days later, Felix came with his wife Drusilla, who was Jewish. He sent for Paul and listened to him as he spoke about faith in Jesus Christ. Now, mind you, this is so good because Felix went to Paul with his wife to ask him about what's going on, but he also wanted to hear about Jesus Christ. He wanted to hear about the gospel. He did it with just him and his wife. He didn't do it with Lysias. He didn't do it with other commanders. He didn't do it with other centurions. He did it on his own. But guess what? Felix started getting a little agitated because the same way that Herod married his wife, he married Drusilla the same way. He basically was committing adultery when he married his wife Drusilla. And guess what? When Paul was talking, he just started shutting them up. He's like, okay, I don't want to hear no more. Because he started getting agitated. Do you know that when you start speaking the gospel and it starts messing with people's soul, and it starts, people say, the pastor's stepping on my feet. When it starts making you move your feet, when you start getting moving in your chair and getting agitated because you're doing stuff you ain't got no business, you don't want to hear the word no more. This is what he says. As Paul talked about righteousness, self-control, and the judgment to come, Felix was afraid and said, that's enough for now. He like, all right, I don't want to hear no more. That's enough. Because he was doing stuff he had no business. He took his wife the same way that Herod took his wife. When he took his wife and took her from the man and got his her husband killed, that's the same exact way that Felix got his wife. He was committing adultery. So I'm telling y'all, don't be afraid to teach the word. You got to teach the word in season and out of season. Because guess what? When you're teaching the word of God, they will get agitated. And they will just be like, you know what? I don't want to hear the word no more. Because you are teaching what they need to hear. And the enemy in them will start getting riled up and be like, you know what? I don't want to hear no more. I don't want to hear what you got to say. Come on. No, no, no. And they walk away. They don't want to hear it because you are teaching the word. And you are bothering their spirit. And that's what started happening. Because he was teaching faith and he was teaching righteousness, Paul kept going on teaching, but Felix didn't want to hear it no more. He didn't want to hear it no more. He said, that's enough for now. Don't get to the point where you don't want to hear the pastor no more. Don't get to the point where you don't want to hear the minister no more because you're doing wrong. Get yourself together, repent, ask for forgiveness, and then get convicted. Because conviction is good. Conviction gets you in place. Conviction gets you right. Just know that. He told Paul, you may leave now. When I find it convenient, I will send for you. The word of God, it cuts like a two-edged sword. It ain't supposed to be convenient. It ain't supposed to always feel good. It ain't supposed to always tickle your ears. It ain't always supposed to make you feel good and go get you hype. Oh, church was good today. Oh, it was exciting. Oh, my God. When you're in the wrong place, when you're doing stuff wrong, when you're not doing right, guess what? God will prick your heart and he will convict you. It's necessary. It ain't supposed to be good. He said when it's convenient. The word of God ain't supposed to be convenient. It's supposed to convict. It's supposed to get you back in right standing. Them crooked places are supposed to get straight. And it gets straight from the word. That's why you got to hear the word weekly. That's why you got to study the word daily. Because you need conviction. And you know that thing in yourself. Like, ooh, I shouldn't have did that. Oh, my God. And you know we all feel conviction when you're a child of the king. You feel conviction even when you're not a child of the king. The spirit tells you. You had that unction in your heart. You feel it in your stomach like, I shouldn't have did that. That's conviction. And it's necessary. It helps you. He said, when I find it convenient, I will send for you. At the same time, he was hoping that Paul would offer him a bribe. Come on, ain't nobody bribing you to get right. He said he was hoping that Paul would offer him a bribe. So he sent for him frequently and talked with him. He started sending for him all the time. Paul was actually locked up with Felix and at this time for 2 whole years. And Felix constantly kept going for Paul, talking to him about Jesus Christ. He wanted to know about Christ, but he wanted him to offer him a bribe. Like, bribe me. Do something to make me become a Christian. But Paul wasn't bribing him. He's like, I'm not going to bribe you. I'm just going to give you the truth. I'm going to give you the gospel. Ain't nobody bribing you. Why should we bribe you when we don't have to? If the word is preached, God will do the rest. The Holy Spirit will do the work. All I got to do is teach the word. And the word works. The word will do it. I ain't got to teach nothing else but the sound word. That's why I tell y'all, when y'all study the word and then you give it to somebody else, you can't just be teaching the word. You got to walk the word too. Don't come telling me about the word and you doing stuff you ain't got no business. You got to be in right standing. You got to be righteous so when you teach the word, it will convict the other person. You got to give the truth and the truth hurts. It won't always feel good. It don't always feel good, but it helps you. It gets you back in place. It gets you back on the right path. Stop always wanting to be a good word. Oh, that word was good. Oh, that word was good. No, get your butt together. Get right. You got to get the word in your spirit that when stuff is wrong, and you say, you know what, Lord, I'm going to get right because that was for me. That was for me. I know I'm messing up. I know I'm constantly saying, Lord, forgive me, forgive me, forgive me. Stop doing that. You got to get right. It says he sent for him frequently and talked with him. When 2 years had passed, somebody say 2 years, he was locked up for 2 years. And Paul taught him the word for 2 years. We don't have that much time. The way people are dying right now, we need today. All you got is today. We don't got next month. We don't got next week. People are getting sick and dying right before our very eyes. He preached to him for 2 years, waiting for a bride. I'm telling you today. It says Felix was succeeded by Porcius Festus. But because Felix wanted to grant a favor to the Jews, he left Paul in prison. Felix, after learning all that word, after talking to Paul all that time, he still was in a place where he said, you know what? I'm going to leave myself. I'm going to get out of office and I'm going to leave Paul here. I'm not going to be the one to let Paul go. Even though he didn't taught me the word for all this time, I'm going to leave it in the hands of somebody else. Let me tell you something. You cannot afford to wait 2 years to get yourself together. You cannot afford to wait. Today is all you got to get yourself together. Today is it. You got to know that this is it. That Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins. That his blood was shed for you. That he walked miles and miles and miles up the road of Calvary. And he did it for you so that your sins can be forgiven. You don't have 2 years to get out of office. You don't have 2 years to get yourself together. You don't have 2 years to say, oh my God, I'm gonna change my life. Oh, I'm gonna stop smoking. I'm gonna stop drinking. I'm gonna stop committing adultery. I'm gonna get myself together. I'm gonna stop lying. I'm gonna stop gossiping. You don't have time. You gotta get yourself together now. You gotta get yourself together. Shake yourself loose. Shake the devil off today. This is it. We don't have January. You waiting for 2021 to get yourself together. This is it. This is all we got. We don't have no other day. He died on the cross some 2,000 years ago for your sins. And now that you hear me, I'm telling you, today is all you got. People are dropping dead. And if I'm giving you the gospel today, I'm telling you that his blood was shed for your sins. I don't care how low you are. I don't care how bad it looks. I don't care what situation you are. I don't care how many people have died in your life. I don't care what has happened for you. I'm telling you that today is all you got. And you got to get yourself together so that you can see your loved one again. You got to get your heart right. You got to get your soul right. You don't have that much time. This is it. Do you know that when Michael Jackson made his very last song, his very last tour, his tour was called This Is It. Do you know that he spoke the word and it happened? He spoke it. He said, this is it. And guess what? That was it. But I'm telling you that this is it. This is all you have. Salvation is free. And today is all you got. I'm giving you a ticket of salvation. This is a free ticket. I give these out all the time. It's a ticket of salvation. It's free. I'm giving you the ticket today to be saved. To be saved for real. I know you've been on live every week since we've been in the pandemic with me. I know you've been studying the word with us. But are you saved for real? Are you baptized by the Holy Ghost? Are you in right standing with God? Are you righteous? Are you making a change? Are you tasting the word and seeing that it's good? What are you doing with your life? Are you making decisions every day to change? What are you doing? This is it. And Felix had the opportunity to remove Paul, but he did not, because he was just like Nicodemus at the time. He walked away in the middle of the night. He did not. But we don't know if Felix's heart was changed. We don't know if Felix's heart was rearranged. We don't know if he got saved at one of those opportunities. I'm telling you today that this is it. This is all you got. And I'm giving you a ticket today. This is a free ticket to your salvation. You don't have tomorrow. We don't have to wait till Christmas. We don't have to wait till New Year's Eve. You got to do it now. All you got to do is surrender all and say, God, I am trying to get my life together. I need you to sit with me. I need you to help me. I need you to come and come into the areas that I'm weak in. I need you to see my broken places. I need you to see the areas that my spirit is crushed. I need you to come because I'm broken. I'm weak. I'm tired. I can't run no more. It's hurting. It feels bad. I'm tired, Lord. I'm in pain. He will come and sit with you. But you just have to be willing to just say, I want to be free. And I need you to come. He's gracious. And he's merciful. He don't care what you've done. He already know. But I'm telling you, you got to just be willing to just say, I'm done. Because this is it. I don't have tomorrow. I don't have next week. I don't have next month. I need to know, what do I need to do? And Felix had the opportunity. Paul had the chance to tell his story. And also when he told his story, he gave everything he had. He said, I didn't do nothing wrong. All I did was study the word. All I did was love God. And I'm telling you, they have nothing against me. Nothing to kill me. Nothing for me to be killed. I didn't do anything wrong. Why are you killing me? Why the enemy on my tracks? Why the devil want to hurt me? God, why are you allowing the devil to just be on my neck? Well, I'm telling you, he want to see how strong your faith is. Let me see if you really want me. Let me see if you really need me. Let me see if it's really impossible for you. Because everything that's impossible for you, it's not impossible for me. It's possible with me. But he want to see your heart. He want to see your faith. He want to see. And I'm telling you that he will do it. And he won't wait long to do it. Because he will see your sincerity. It's in your heart. The Holy Ghost will show up. Come on. The Holy Ghost will show up on your behalf. He will show up. And just say, I can't take it no more. I surrender all. My cup is empty. Now you fill me up, God. God will fill you up. And all it takes is you saying, God, I need you. I have sinned. I have messed up. I have made wrong decisions. I have coveted people's wives and people's husbands. I have done stuff I had no business. I have stole. I have murdered. I did things that was not contrary, that was contrary to your word. But I'm telling you, God, from this day forward, from this day, December 13th, no longer will I let the enemy guide me. I will let you guide me, God. You got to say it out of your own mouth. He said, you got to confess with your mouth and believe with your heart that Jesus is Lord, that he is Jehovah, that he is Elohim, that he is a rock, that he is a redeemer, that he is a way maker, that he is a promise keeper, that he is a mind regulator. Come on, that he's a way. He makes the way in a desert storm. He makes a way in the dry places. He makes the crooked places straight. He is whatever you need him to be. But you got to get to know him. And if you don't know him today, I'm telling you, don't wait 2 years. This is all you got. You got to say, Lord Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God. You got to say, I believe that you came to earth. He walked the earth for us. You got to say, I believe that you died on the cross for me. This is what separates us from every religion, that he died on the cross for us. You got to know it. I don't care how good the praise dancer is. I don't care how good the choir is. I don't care how good the church look. I don't care how much money the church bring in. You got to know in your own heart that he died on the cross for your sins. That separates you from every other religion. You got to know that thing. And you got to believe that he shed his blood for you. You got to say this out of your mouth. I believe you shed your blood for me. And I believe you rose from the dead. The Pharisees and the Sadducees, they fought over this part. That he rose from the dead. They didn't believe in the resurrection of Christ. But we know that he rose. 3 days later, he rose. You got to believe that. You got to say, right now, I come to you, Lord Jesus, because I am a sinner. We sin every day. You will never not sin. He knows you're going to sin. You got to say it out of your mouth. I am a sinner. I am a sinner, but forgive my sins because of his blood shed on the cross. He will forgive every single sin you ever done. Every single sin. Not one will he leave on the table. But you got to believe that thing. It's hard to believe it. It's hard to say, God, forgive me. You go right back to it again. You go right back to it next month. You feel like he didn't believe you. But I'm telling you, because of the blood, he will wipe away every sin. It's because of the blood. You got to believe that when you say, forgive me, that it's done. You got to know that he can cleanse you with his blood. You can be sanctified. You can be purified because of his blood. It says, the word says, cleanse me with your blood and make me clean. Just say that out of your mouth. Forgive my sins. Cleanse me with your blood and make me clean. That's all Felix had to say. Don't wait for no bribe. Ain't nobody bribing you. I'm telling you today that he will forgive you no matter what you've done. Only you know what you've done. You are a sinner. He will make you clean and you will be clean. Somebody say, I will be clean. Say, come into my heart. Save my soul. Come into my heart. Our hearts are callous. Our hearts are mean. Our hearts are angry. Ask God to come into your heart and change whatever you have on your heart. People have so much on their heart, their hearts are heavy. But I'm telling you that you can ask God to come into my heart and save my soul. Because when we die, this shell is dying, but the soul goes with God. And when the soul goes with him, it's the soul that he's after. It ain't how cute you are. It ain't how bad you are. It ain't how many degrees you got. It ain't how much money you have. It's the soul that he's coming after. It's the soul. And then you can say, no longer do I belong to Satan. I belong to you. All the bad things that we've been doing in our lives, all the things that's not good, all the things that look dim and grimy, and you know, you've been doing stuff, you had no business, all the stuff you've done years ago, you can ask God to forgive you because you was hanging with Satan. But I'm telling you today, you don't have to hang with Satan no more. You can say, no longer do I belong to Satan. I belong to you. No longer. I am forever yours and I am now saved. That's all it takes is for you to believe it in your heart and to say it out of your mouth. And that's all Felix had to do, was to say it out of his mouth. People be afraid to say it out of their mouth, but I'm telling you today, all you got to do is say it out of your mouth. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we bless your holy and righteous name. We thank you, God, for another opportunity to get it right. Father, we thank you that Paul was able to give his testimony once again and had an opportunity to teach Felix and his wife that what they were doing with committing adultery, they were wrong. But God, I'm telling you, That when you allow us to speak to our family and our friends, allow the Holy Ghost to do the work. Allow us not to do the work. Allow us to just spit up what we have learned. Allow us to regurgitate the word so that when we speak, it will be you speaking on our behalf. God, we need you today to help us save our family, God. Let us not keep our family behind. Let us pull our family with us, God. Let us not leave our family behind. God, we want our family to go with us. Sisters growing strong. No woman left behind. No family left behind. We don't want to leave our family members behind. Not in this season. People are dying so fast. So God, give us the right words to say to our family members so they can become Christians with us. So they can become righteous with us. So that they know when they go through issues and problems and circumstances that they have someone to call on. Let us be the one. Let us be the example. Use us, God. Use us. Use us, God. Use me, God. Father, we thank you. We thank you for constantly allowing us to hear your word. We thank you for allowing us to massage our hearts that we might receive. Father, we thank you for allowing us to be children. We thank you, God, for allowing us to be your child. We love you today, God. We honor you today, God. We thank you that you have forgiven us for our sins because of your blood shed on the cross. We honor you, God. And we thank you. We love you today, God. We ask you to continue to heal, deliver, and set free. Father, we surrender all right now. We surrender all. Somebody's on this line today that just did not know you, that just did not know they were forgiven instantly. Father, I ask you to touch their hearts right now. Father, let them know that you are a healer, that you are a deliverer, that you are a salvation, that you are amazing, that you are a miracle worker, that you are a promise keeper, that you are a way in every situation. You make the way. So, Father, we love you today. We thank you for your Shekinah glory. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. God, we ask you to continue to touch us throughout this week. Let us not go another day without shouting your name. Let us continue to praise your name. Father, we honor you today. In Jesus' name, we pray with thanksgiving. Our heart says amen. Amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. I am excited because I don't want to be like Felix leaving and not being able to say, I want to be saved. What must I do to be saved? We know what it is to do to be saved. But I'm telling you, for those that do not know, all you got to do is surrender all. All you got to do is just believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord. And to say it out of your mouth, you got to just confess out of your mouth. I'm excited because we have next Sunday. Guess what, y'all? Next Sunday. Next Sunday is going to be amazing. We are going to have our turkey basket giveaway with the Omega Psi Phi Epsilon Pi chapter. And I'm so thankful for them wanting to connect with SGS Ministry. We have gotten so many donations. I'm telling y'all. I first want to tell y'all to please delete Rashida Myers Lee Cash App. Do not send any more money to that Cash App. That Cash App has been hacked. Please send your Cash App to $SGS Ministry 18. Do not send it to Rashida Myers Lee. Y'all, we have gotten so many gloves, so many hats, so many scarves, so many socks, so much food already. People are donating. And guess what? Do y'all know that The company that I use for the Feeding the 4,000 on Wednesdays, which is Philly Food Rescue, they called me last Sunday and Susanna said to me, Rashida, we got a big check from Keystone Mercy and they wanted to donate it to an organization that is consistent in their works in the community. And we couldn't think of no one else but you. Come on. Do you hear me? They said they couldn't think of no one else but me. They said, do you have anything else going on by the end of the year? And I said, yes, we have a turkey giveaway on Sunday. She said, well, we're going to find a way to make sure that you get all that you need in produce to give away. Y'all, let me tell you, your name got to be on somebody's lips with greatness. But it's how you treat people. It's how consistent you are. It's how faithful you are. God will put your name on people's heart. Come on. They said they had a check and they couldn't think about nobody else but SGS Ministry. Come on. Let me tell y'all that God is putting your name in people's mouths in this season. My girlfriend Geneva was at the shop yesterday and she said, Sheeta, I got this stuff from my daycare. She brought all these hats and gloves. And she said, I told my husband the other night that I wanted to honor you. I wanted to have you put on, I think it was Channel 12 for the Hometown Hero. I told my husband, I want to put Sheeta's name in the basket for that. I'm like, for real? I'm like, I almost about to cry. I'm like, oh my God, my name is really on people's lips, on people's hearts. She said, for the hometown hero. What have I done? I have not done nothing but been consistent in God's business. Then the owner of CMP Radio, Pierre, calls me the other day and just said, hey, Rashida, how are you? I said, how you doing, Pierre? What's going on? He said, I just called to check on you to see how you doing. I said, I'm doing good. He said, I just want to check on you because I know you're so strong and you're doing so much in the community. I just want to know that I was thinking about you. And I want to let you know to continue to be strong, continue to go forth in what you're doing. I'm telling y'all, I was shocked. I'm like, Pierre, you calling me? He's the owner of CMP Radio, y'all. Let me tell you, you just don't know that when you're doing something for the kingdom, when you deny yourself, when you put God's business first, he will use people to bless you. It won't always come with money. It will just come from their lips. How people will talk about you in a good way. How people will use you in a good way. How people will speak on your behalf in a good way. I'm telling you, I'm nobody. I'm nothing. I'm just a regular old hairdresser. That's it. But God using me. He seen my faults. He seen me in my sin. He seen me when I was a mess. He seen me when I was messing with people's husbands. He seen me when I was constantly having abortions. He seen me when I was continuing to run around. When I was doing everything I had no business. When I was promiscuous. When I was laying up with this man and that man. He seen when I was doing stuff with my money. Doing stuff I ain't had no business. He seen when I was doing drugs. When I was constantly on ecstasy pills. He seen when I was doing things. He seen me in my sin. But guess what? He blotted it out. And guess what? He still saved me. He saved me out of all of my troubles. He saved me from all of my sins. And guess what? He seen my heart that I wanted to change, that I wanted to be used. And he's using me. And now my name is on people's lips. But guess what? It's all because of you. Because of your consistency. SGS Ministry, from the men and the women constantly helping. I cannot be nothing without you. Let me tell you, I'm just like Christ. He had 12 people around him. I got y'all. I need your help to constantly be able to go forth. So I'm telling you, you need your own people to keep pushing you. But ain't nobody pushing you if they're pushing you into sin. God wants you to be pushed into greatness. Y'all pushing me into greatness. Y'all pushing me to study the word. Y'all pushing me to do what's right. It's because of you. So I'm telling you to continue to ask God to push you. Continue to ask God to show you your areas of where you need to grow stronger so that you can be used in the kingdom. This is his kingdom. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. I'm doing what's necessary for the kingdom. And his will is being done in my life. But he can do the same thing for you. He can use you to bless others. That's what this thing is all about. It's all about helping others. Jesus Christ talks about nothing else. He don't care about our successes. He don't care about you getting honored and recognized on stages and platforms. He don't care about that. But when you helping his people, he will take care of you. I'm telling you, he will take care of you. He will cover you. He will protect you on every side. He will be your fence. And when your assignment is up, it will be well with your soul. Your family will be well with it because they know you have done everything you were supposed to do in this season. So I'm telling you today to be the hometown hero for your family. Be the hometown hero for your organizations, for your area, wherever you're from. Let somebody say that about you because of you studying the word, because you changed. Do you know that you can change just like that? I don't care what yesterday looked like. I don't care what last week looked like. I was a mess. I didn't go nowhere without being naked. I didn't go nowhere without my cleavage out. I didn't go nowhere without tights on, with booty shorts on, with half of my butt hanging out. I was that person, the one that you talk about. Them girls, you say, oh, she need to get that off. She need to take that off. That was me. But I'm telling you, that when God get a hold of you, he will change your life. And that's what he has done for me. So I'm telling you today, you can be the hometown hero for just your family members. You can be the hometown hero for just your children, for your life. Somebody's looking at you. Somebody's watching you. And somebody needs you. This is the day that the Lord has made. And I'm so excited. If you have any questions, any concerns, you can always email me. Never be afraid to email me. Never be afraid to call me. Never be afraid to reach out. I am reachable. I am touchable. I am Rashida Myers Lee. I am your reverend for the hour, and I bless your holy name, God. We thank you for consistency If you don't do anything else in this season, I ask you to be consistent. Be consistent in everything that you do. Be consistent in everything that you do. Don't start and stop. Be consistent. I told Miss Bernadette the other day, she has a restaurant called Aunt B's. And her and I was talking when I was doing her hair. And she said, Rashida, my business is doing so good, even through the pandemic. And I said, it's because of your consistency. Consistency matters. She said, that's what you told me when I first started. If not, don't do nothing else to be consistent. And that's what she been. You have to be consistent in whatever you do. No matter what. I'm consistent. I love y'all. I love y'all. I love y'all. I can't wait to see y'all next Sunday. I might need y'all on next Saturday if Philly Food Rescue bring the food on Saturday. I might need some volunteers on Saturday. So I'll let you guys know. I'll put it on my page if I need help the bag on Saturday and Sunday. So right now, we're excited about Sunday. At 12 to 3, we will have the giveaways. And we will have you guys set up on from 9 to 11:30 when we pack bagging the food. I love you. Have a blessed day. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you.